हेलो स्टूडेंट्स, टुडे आई एम गोइंग टू डिस्कस द चैप्टर मैग्नेटिक प्रॉपर्टीज ऑफ ट्रांजिशन मेटल कॉम्प्लेक्सेस। सपोज वी हैव ए कंपाउंड और ए कॉम्प्लेक्स एंड इट इज डिस्प्लेइंग सम मैग्नेटिक प्रॉपर्टीज। एट दैट केस वी से दैट इट माइट हैव सम अनपेयर्ड इलेक्ट्रॉन्स एंड सिंस द ट्रांजिशन मेटल कॉम्प्लेक्सेस आर जनरली हैविंग पार्शली फिल्ड D or F subshells, therefore depending upon their oxidation state, electronic configuration and the coordination number of central metal atom or ion, a wide range of magnetic properties are expected in them. The magnetic properties can provide a useful information for understanding the structure and bonding in the transition metal complexes. The molecules which are having the unpaired electrons, they can be magnetized by external magnetic field and therefore they are called as the para magnetic substances. What is going to happen in the paramagnetic substances? An external magnetic field, it lines up the electron spin parallel to the magnetic field. Means if the magnetic field is flowing in this direction, then if a paramagnetic substance is placed in the field of magnetic lines of force, then the spin of electrons will lines up in the direction of the magnetic fields, and therefore the paramagnetic substance behave like a magnet in the external applied magnetic field. On the other hand, a diamagnetic substance which have paired electrons and their opposite spins cancelling each other magnetic field, it cannot be magnetized by the external magnetic field. That is why they are known as the diamagnetic substances. Okay. Next we have, what is the origin of paramagnetic movement? The answer of this question lies in the fact that the magnetic property of a substance arises from both electrons as well as the nucleons, that is the protons. However, the contribution of magnetic behavior from electrons is 1000 times that of the protons. Why it is so? Because the mass of proton is around 1850 times that of the mass of electrons. That means the protons are much more heavier than that of the electrons. That is why their spin or their movement is very, very less or slow. So we can say that the proton have negligible spin as compared to that of the spin of the electrons. Therefore, the contribution of nucleons to the magnetic behavior can be neglected, and the mainly the electron determine the magnetic behavior. The electron determine the magnetic properties in the substances in two ways. As first one is the spin of the electron. Second, the movement of electrons in orbital. Means the electron spin around their own axis as well as they move around the nucleus in the orbitals. Whenever an electron move in the orbital, so we can say that a charged particle is moving in a circular loop, so it will produce some magnetic field. However, the electrons are also spinning around their own axis, just like the planets, they spin around their own axis as well as around the sun. So we can say that the electrons have the two types of spin, one on their own axis, other around the orbitals. So both of these type of spins, which are associated with the electrons, it produce some magnetic field. The magnetic field which is produced due to the spin of the electron is known as the spin magnetic moment, whereas the magnetic moment which is produced because of the movement in an orbital, it is known as the orbital magnetic movement. Okay, so the magnetic moment of a substance are generally expressed in the Bohr magnetron. A unit which is given to the magnetic moment is known as the Bohr magnetron. And the magnetic moment electron, which is having a charge E and mass m, is given as mu s, which is equal to E h upon 4 pi m c, where h is the Planck constant, c is the velocity of light, m is the mass of electron, and e is the charge of electron. Okay, so the value of mu s as obtained by this expression is around 9.274 into 10 raised to the power minus 21 ergs per gauss. Okay, so this is taken as one unit of magnetic moment. So we can say that one Bohr magnetron is equal to the EH upon 4 pi mc. Next we have the calculation of spin magnetic moment. The spin magnetic moment, that is mu s, for a single electron or the atoms or ions having the more than one electron, one unpaired electrons, can be calculated by a relation, that is mu s is equal to g into root of s into s plus 1, where the g is known as the gyro magnetic ratio, and it is also known as the g factor and the Landes factor. It is actually the ratio of magnetic moment to the angular momentum. That is why it is called as the gyromagnetic ratio. Okay, and for a free ion, the g is equal to 2.00023, which may be taken as equal to 2 for the practical purposes. Now, substituting the value of g and value of s, where here s is the spin quantum number. Okay, for one electron system it is equal to half, and for the atoms or ions which are having more than one unpaired electrons, so it can be the sum of the spin of the electrons. So let us take some examples to understand this equation, and let us calculate the magnetic moment of various atoms or ions which are having the unpaired electrons. Now suppose we have hydrogen atom or the copper 2 ion. Both of these ions or atoms are having the one unpaired electron in them. Therefore, they have the spin quantum number is equal to half. So the spin magnetic moment will be equal to 2 half into half plus 1. So it comes out to be root 3, which is equal to 1.732. So the atoms or ions which are having one electron should have the spin magnetic moment is equal to 1.732 Bohr magnetron from the electron spin only. And for the atoms or ions which are having more than one unpaired electrons, so we can calculate their spin magnetic moment by this relation. Just take some examples. So suppose we have titanium 3 positive, okay, which have only one unpaired electron, so it will also have the same magnetic moment. And if we have the chromium 3 positive, which is having 4 unpaired electrons, so 4 unpaired electrons, the total spin quantum number will be equal to half plus half is equal to 2. So we can calculate easily. So mu s will be equal to 2 plus 1, which is equal to root 24. So it will be equal to 4.90 Bohr magnetron. As the value of G is taken as the 2, so the relation which is equal to G into S plus 1 can be written as 4S into S plus 1. So either we can use this relation or directly this relation. So it will be easier to write this relation and calculate the magnetic moment. Suppose we have one unpaired electron. So for that case, the S will be equal to half. So just putting the value in this relation, we can easily calculate the magnetic moment. So here we have the 2. So we can write it as a 2 into 3 by 2. So again, we have root 3, that is equal to 1.732 Bohr magnetron. Now these are the spin only values of magnetic moment calculated for some of the metal ions with having the number of unpaired electrons from 0 to 10. And these are their experimental values which are observed through the experiments. So we can see that the observed experimental values of the magnetic moment of some of the transitional metals ions agrees very well with the spin only values. However, in some cases the experimental value differ from the spin only value, usually being somewhat larger. So this is because in addition to the spin of the electrons, the orbital motion of the electron also make a contribution to the magnetic moment. In these cases, the orbital magnetic moment, which is dependent of both the spin and orbital magnetic moment, is given as a relation, that is mu s plus l equals to root 4 s into s plus 1 plus l plus 1, where s is the resultant spin angular momentum and l is the resultant orbital angular momentum quantum number. If you observe carefully, the experimental values of the metal ions which are having the values higher than the spin only value, so we can see that the experimental values are little bit higher than that of the spin only values. So this means that we can say the contribution of magnetic moment due to the orbital motion of the electron is very very small. In other words, we can say the orbital moments are completely or partially quenched. This is because the electric field of the ligand surrounding the metal ion restrict the orbital motion of the electrons. And in case of second and third row transition elements, and particularly in the lanthanide elements, where the unpaired electrons occupy the 4f orbitals, the orbital motion is not prevented or quenched. And this is because the 4f orbitals are very well shielded from the surrounding by overlaying 5s and 5p subshells. As a result of this, the electric field of the ligands which are surrounding the metal ions does not restrict the orbital motion of the electrons. Thus, the orbital contribution to the magnetic moment is not quenched, or therefore, the magnetic moment of the lanthanide ions are due to the both electron spin as well as the orbital motion of the electrons. And these may be calculated by using this equation. Also, in some cases, there is a coupling between the spin contribution and the orbital contribution. That is, there is a coupling between the S and L. So, there are three types of coupling between the spin quantum number and the orbital quantum number. That is, spin-spin contribution or spin-spin coupling, orbital coupling, or spin orbital coupling. In lanthanide metal ions, all these three types of interactions plays a important role. In such cases, the resultant magnetic moment can be calculated by means of the Russell-Sounder coupling, which is known as the LS coupling, which is given by a relation, that is mu is equal to G root J into J plus 1, where the J is the total angular momentum, which is the vectorial sum of total orbital angular momentum, that is L, plus the total spin angular momentum. And G is known as the Landes splitting factor. Okay, so it can be calculated for any species containing the unpaired electrons with the help of the relation, that is equal to G is equal to 1 plus S into S plus 1 minus L into L plus 1 plus J into J plus 1 upon the 2 J J plus 1. So next we have the measurement of magnetic properties. The magnetic moments are not measured directly. However, the parameters which is actually measured is known as the magnetic susceptibility. Which is denoted by a symbol psi, from which it is possible to measure the magnetic moment. This magnetic susceptibility is a measure of the capacity of a substance to take up the magnetization in an applied magnetic field. If a substance is placed in a magnetic field of strength H, then the magnetic flux within it will be given as B is equal to H plus 4 pi I, where I is the intensity of magnetization. Okay, and if we divide this whole relation with H, we get B by H is equal to 1 plus 4 pi I upon H. The ratio B by H is called as the magnetic permeability. Okay, and the I upon H is called as the magnetic susceptibility per unit volume, or simply the volume susceptibility. Okay, so this I by H can be written as a symbol kappa ओके, एज द रेशियो ऑफ बी बाय एच इज नोन एज द मैग्नेटिक परमेबिलिटी, सो इट गिव्स द रेशियो ऑफ डेंसिटी ऑफ लाइन्स ऑफ फोर्स विद इन द सब्सटेंस टू द डेंसिटी ऑफ सच लाइन्स इन द सेम रीजन इन द एब्सेंस ऑफ द सब्सटेंस. देयरफॉर द मैग्नेटिक सटेबिलिटी ऑफ वैक्यूम इज ऑब्वियसली अ जीरो बिकॉज बाय डेफिनेशन द बी बाय एच विल बी इक्वल टू 1. सो पुटिंग द वैल्यू 1 प्लस 4 पाई के इज इक्वल टू 1 और के इज इक्वल टू 0. सो फॉर पैरामैग्नेटिक सब्सटेंसेस द फ्लक्स इज ग्रेटर विद इन द सब्सटेंस देन इट वुड बी इन वैक्यूम. Thus, the paramagnetic substances have the positive susceptibilities. Similarly, if we calculate the susceptibility for diamond substance, it comes out to be negative because the lines of force from induced dipole cancel out the lines of force due to the applied field. And in that case, the B by H will be less than 1. And if we divide kappa with the density of the substance, we get the mass susceptibility that is equal to psi. So it is known as the mass susceptibility. Okay. And if we multiply the mass susceptibility with the molar mass of the substance, we get the molar susceptibility. Or simply we can say that kappa into m upon rho is equal to the molar susceptibility, okay, where m is the molar mass of the compound. Next we have the experimental measurement of the magnetic moments. There are numerous methods for the measurement of the magnetic susceptibility. However, the two most important methods are the Gauss method and second is the Faraday's method. In my next video, I will discuss both these methods in detail. So, I stop my lecture here. Thank you. Have a nice day.